Okay. Good morning and welcome to this, the fourth meeting of the Equality and Human Rights Committee of 2017. Make the usual request that mobile phones be switched on silent or air flight mode. Our first agenda item this morning is a decision on whether to take agenda item three in private or committee content to take agenda item three private. Three and four, in private.
Yeah, agreed.
Thank you very much. And our substantive agenda item this morning is agenda item two, which is a report from the Equality and Human Rights Commission. We're going to take some evidence on the UK business plan and how these priorities relate to Scotland. Can we thank you for copies of the business plan? I was up at 6.30 this morning and read it cover to cover. So thanks for that. But can I welcome both our witnesses this morning. Rebecca Hilsenrath is the Chief Executive Officer of the Equality and Human Rights Commission, and Chris Oswald, who's the Head of Policy in Scotland at the Commission. Chris, you've been to committee before and we welcome you back. And Rebecca, I know this is your first time at this committee and we're very grateful for you coming along, and we're really interested to hear what you have to say this morning. So I believe you've got a brief opening statement you would like to make.
Thank you, Convener. Well, just really to say that I'm very grateful to all of you for inviting us here today. And as you say, it's my first time speaking to this committee. In fact, it's my first time in this building, but it's not my first time in Scotland. I've been the chief executive for 18 months, and before that I was the chief legal officer, and I come up to our Glasgow office very regularly indeed, and the work of our office here is very important to me, and be very happy to talk about that more, as I'm sure that I will in the course of questions during this morning. But I do appreciate very much the opportunity to talk to you. It's about us understanding more what your concerns and your perspective are, and it's also an opportunity for us to explain more of what we're doing. So I appreciate the opportunity very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We've obviously, this is a relatively new committee in this guise, because of new responsibilities conferred on the Scottish Parliament. So the old Equal Opportunities Committee has been expanded to take into account equalities and human rights. So it cuts across all of those aspects, and we're taking on that work with some vigour, with some of the inquiries that we've launched. I see that you've got a couple of strategic aims in your plan that relate to Scotland. And I know there's some UK-wide aspects of the work that you're doing that affect Scotland as well. Could you give us a wee overview of maybe the strategic plans that you have that would, you know, be an overview for the whole of the UK, but sort of a focus in on the ones that would be specific to Scotland?
I'm happy to. I think we might sort of play a bit of a double act, Chris and me, and it's kind of easier in a way for me to talk about the Commission as a whole and for Chris to talk about how we're operating in Scotland specifically. In terms of our strategic plan, we have four strategic objectives. We're looking at, first of all, looking at evidence. It's important for us to ensure that there's a sufficient evidence base for what we're doing. And that's been about looking at our report, which was a five-yearly function in terms of looking at equality and human rights outcomes across GB, which we're now going to be doing every 3 years. We're looking at changing the measurement framework for that, and we're looking at identifying where the missing gaps have been, coming out of Is Britain Fairer, Is Scotland Fairer, to ensure that our evidence base is improved going forward. That's one strategic objective. Another is around ensuring an appropriate and robust infrastructure for equality and human rights. That's about our treaty monitoring work, and it's also about our Access to Justice project, looking at how we can ensure better outcomes in that place, again, across GB. We're also looking at our third objective, I may have got them the wrong way around, looking at significant impact in human rights and equality. That's about our strategic litigation work. It's also about our inquiries work and our investigations. And fourth, we're looking at increasing our own capability in terms of the way we operate as a GB and a Scottish and Welsh organisation, and that's about the work that we're doing at the moment, both in terms of our structure but also in terms of our systems and IT and offices going forward. I don't in terms of what we're looking at specifically going forward, we're in the business planning stage, as you appreciate, looking forward to the 17-18 year. I don't know whether you wanted to talk specifically about Scotland in that regard, Chris.
Absolutely. It may be at this stage easier if I kind of reel off a list of things which we've got interests in, and if you want to come back to me about detail on any of them, more than happy to talk you through that. Our work programme in Scotland is very much driven by the publication that we released last year, is Scotland Fairer, which is a compendium of the big data about equality and fairness in Scotland. So we take our working priorities very much from that. The seven of those, the first, which is a very much one very familiar to the committee, is about the lack of evidence in Scotland around diversity and human rights. We have particular concerns about attainment, in education. We have particular issues around employment, recruitment, retention, and reward in employment. We are very interested in community relations, particularly issues around hate crime, targeted crime. We have strong interests in participation, public participation, again, through the lens of protected characteristics, the nine groups that we work with, and the human rights aspirations around participation. Access to justice, not as strong perhaps a priority in Scotland, given the commitments to employment tribunal fees that have been made, which are very welcome. Concerns around health, and then concerns about very basic issues of, I think, harassment, security, and the ability to live independently. Breaking that down into kind of specifics, in terms of employment work, I'm sure the committee's aware we've been doing a lot of work on pregnancy discrimination. We estimate 5,500 women lose their jobs in Scotland every year because of pregnancy discrimination, and we are doing a lot of work with the Scottish Government on that. We have a very strong focus on equal pay and pay gaps, and we also have a very strong interest in board diversity, whether that be private boards, public sector boards, or the boards of private companies. In terms of our legal work, we accept cases, we make interventions in courts, we take cases in our own name. You may well have seen last week we were in the Supreme Court on the what's known as the buggies against wheelchairs issue. In Scotland, as I say, we do legal representation and intervention. We also have a very strong emphasis on transfer of expertise, so skilling up unions, CABs, advice agencies to understand equality and human rights law so that they can represent people themselves. We're coming towards the end of the first four-year cycle of the public sector equality duty phase. On April the 30th, public bodies in Scotland have to publish what they've been doing and what they've achieved over the last 4 years, as well as a new set of outcomes. We have just, pardon me, signed off a major review of that, where we're going to look at the activities and the outcomes that each of the 250 bodies have achieved. So it's a major piece of work. And we'll report back publicly, we anticipate September, to be able to say, with some recommendations about, well, is this working, is that not working, what would we suggest going forward? We've been doing some work around the outcomes of Is Scotland Fairer, particularly around targeted and hate crime, feeding off Duncan Morrow's review and Scottish Social Attitudes Survey. About to do one on participation, where we're very interested in the Scottish Government's support to 1 in 5 and about how do we get greater diversity, whether that be from a tenants association to a community council to elected office. And then attainment, where whilst we support the aims of the Scottish Government in terms of the attainment challenge, we have a concern that issues of differences in attainment between boys and girls, disabled and non-disabled people, gypsy travellers particularly, may not always be being picked up in what is predominantly an anti-deprivation strategy. There's loads of things to talk about. I'll be very brief in the other ones. Particular interest, something which my team are working on just now, is looking at the opportunities that new investment brings to Scotland. Both the affordable housing programmes and the city deals to us represent really major opportunities to take forward critical areas of policy. So taking perhaps the affordable housing one as an example. We are building 50,000 affordable houses. 17,500 wheelchair users in Scotland are inappropriately housed. Ethnic minorities are four times more likely to be overcrowded than anybody else in Scotland. We have a real opportunity here to build housing which starts to take some of that demand out of the system to accommodate people's needs. But then equally, we have a real opportunity to bring women, ethnic minorities and disabled people into the construction industry, where currently they are very, very lowly represented. So we're looking at things like city deals, investment programmes, as opportunities that we can actually both change the physical infrastructure, the places that we live, the places that we work, but also who has the opportunities to work in those places. So we're in conversation with the Scottish Government and ministers just now about just how we coordinate all of that. But there's a real sense, I think, that there's... We want to go beyond just simply helping eliminating discrimination. We want to really seize the opportunity that some of this stuff presents to Scotland and to help public bodies through procurement or planning or monitoring to get it right, to really seize those opportunities. As you probably get it, I could go on for ages, but I won't.
There's lots of questions from committee members. There's two things, Rebecca, I'd quite like to pick up with you in relation to some of the work the committee's doing. You mentioned some of your litigation work. Could you give us some examples of that? And I know about the wheelchair versus the buggies one. We know that one quite well here. I think Lothian buses was one of the issues in that. But maybe if you give us some idea of the litigation work, the work that you're doing, and maybe how the frequency of that compares over maybe the last couple of years.
Thank you. Yes. Well, Chris has stolen my thunder by talking about the Doug Pawley case, which we were, of course, very pleased about. So other recent cases that we've been involved with have involved, for example, the what's known as the bedroom tax. We're involved in a case which looked at the application of that in relation to families with disabled children, and held that it was unlawful in relation to the impact on children in that place. We've also been involved in the last year in relation to various cases which impacted on Gypsy, Roma and Traveller families. That included a case in relation to Wetherspoons for refusal of service on that basis. And it also involved a case in relation, actually I think it was the year before, in relation to referral of case planning applications in relation to Gypsy and Traveller sites in the Greenbelt, where these were under administrative arrangements recovered centrally as opposed to decided locally, and that was held to be a breach of the public sector equality duty. In relation to other cases, we've taken various cases in relation to immigration issues. We're currently in relation to a case in relation to the amount of welfare paid to child immigrants. In relation to other cases recently, I think generally speaking, in terms of the amount of cases that we take, that we're looking at cases which both at an intervention level and also cases that we fully fund, because we're able to take cases both where we intervene as a neutral party in relation as an expert body, or where cases where there is a breach of the Equality Act and we're able to fund them fully. If you look at those cases together, generally speaking, we're taking around about 30 cases a year at the moment. We think that's an area where we used to take more cases, and where one of the issues for us is about how strategic cases are referred into the Commission. We've done an awful lot of work trying to work with stakeholders to increase the number of cases that we take. One of the problems there is around where cases originate. We've struggled in the past to develop a full pipeline of cases coming through from the helpline since that's been outsourced. There are also issues with capacity around the advice services where we work to try to encourage a pipeline of cases, and obviously they're struggling with capacity in relation to cuts that they have been imposed with. We're currently running a pilot for January, February and March this year, looking at a slightly different approach, particularly in relation to disability discrimination cases. And there are two reasons for that. One is that we're obviously able to provide extra support in relation to disability. We know that there are particular issues there, and we think that taking on disability cases is going to help around various bits of work that we are doing, particularly in that field. So, for example, we've just launched a housing inquiry looking into disability access housing across GP, and taking more disability discrimination cases is going to, we hope, is going to help us identify more sort of contextual evidence around problems that people are experiencing in that place. And we're also about to report in relation to the UK's compliance under the CRPD, the Convention for the Rights of People with Disabilities. We also have a report coming out on disability in early March, looking at disability across GB. So that's the reason for looking at disability particularly. But coming back to the question that you asked, we hope that looking at disability discrimination cases in a slightly different way, where we're looking at taking cases at a less strategic level, not necessarily just looking at an appeal case, but also at first instance cases, is going to help us understand how a slightly different approach to litigation may help us to adopt a different way of taking cases on in the future, and maybe help getting more cases going on further into the year. So after that pilot's completed, we'll be looking at identifying impact and seeing whether that helps us increase the pipeline.
Could I perhaps give a brief illustration of how it works practically in Scotland? Just so, a couple of years ago, we were approached by a profoundly deaf woman who required to use a signer. She told us that she had been rushed into hospital for an emergency operation. She was in hospital for 7 days. At no point did the hospital provide a signer. She left hospital having not consented to the operation and not knowing what procedure had been carried out on her. And this is the second time that this had happened to her in 2 or 3 years. We felt the issue was so serious that we commenced litigation, issued a writ against the health board. The health board, as is very often our experience in Scotland, wanted to work with us. We agreed what's called a Section 23 agreement, where the health board signs a legally binding agreement with us, which says they will do a certain amount of things over a set period, which we can take back to court should that not happen. But not just leaving it there, we had concerns that this was not unique to this health board, so we've looked across every health board in Scotland at their practices and policies around signing particularly, and we're now working with the health department to try and get a common approach to providing basic levels of communication support to people who have no other option. So we tend to use litigation where we have to, where the respondent is willing, we will enter into agreements with them, but the aim is very much to then take that to scale so that we don't just have to keep on going through every health board every month. So that's.
And I think if I just to add to that, to operate as a strategic litigator obviously means to use our functions in a way that identifies the cases that are going to make a bigger impact. And we have a strategic litigation policy that identifies what criteria we use to take on a case. And that will include whether there's an opportunity to clarify the law and what the impact of the issue is. But it's also a practical issue because when you take on cases at first instance, they do tend to settle. And therefore, it's about the use of sort of practical and purposes of use of our resources, but it's absolutely the case that the majority of the work that we do is slightly sub-radar in the sense that it does lead to an impact, it leads to settlement, it leads to an addressing of the issues in the case. It just may not lead to a case that goes to court.
Yeah, I think we might come back to capacity issues later, and certainly we'll be coming back to the disability issues when one of my colleagues picks it up. But just one more thing that I wanted to pick up with you, and it's in your strategic plan, and it's about, protecting and promoting the human rights of refugees. You'll know that this committee has put out a call for evidence on destitution and asylum, and we're getting many replies, including from a family in a refugee camp in Turkey, on that. Given the backdrop, I mean, we're looking across the Atlantic with horror, when actually we should be looking at our own back door with horror when it comes to how refugees are treated in this country. We still are the only country in the EU, while we remain in the EU, who has no limit of time on detention. We have the issue that you said with children of asylum seekers plunging deeper and deeper into poverty, which will probably feed into some of the evidence that we'll receive on destitution and the impact that has on vulnerable families. Can you give us a bit of insight into the work that you would be doing to highlight this? My worry is that we're in a situation where certain world leaders have given permission for certain aspects of, you know, reactionary right-wing horrible treatment of people, especially refugees, becomes normalised, and that's my worry. But we still have serious issues in this country of how we treat people seeking sanctuary, and I'm wondering about any work that you're doing on that and how we can maybe work alongside you or complement the work that we are doing on our inquiry in asylum and destitution.
Do you want to start? Do you want me to start?
You've caught it at a point where we are in the middle of business planning, so it's something which we're looking particularly at. We have particular concerns, as well-known concerns, about the housing of asylum seekers. In England, there is more of an issue perhaps about health and access to healthcare. So we are developing plans at the moment, but they are very much shared concerns. I mean, as I'm sure you know, we have quite a strong history of looking at human trafficking in Scotland as well, and both this committee and ourselves have done inquiries and investigations into that. I can't put my hand on my heart today, I'm really sorry, and say this is exactly what we will be doing in 2 months' time, but very much the commitment is there. What we don't want to do is to replicate the same work that you're doing, and the very strong focus. We share, I think, exactly the same concerns around destitution, around intolerable standards of housing, and of the physical and mental harm that's been done to people seeking asylum in the UK. We also have a very strong concern about the public discourse around refugees and asylum seekers, around minority groups generally. We've seen very strong responses in England, Wales and Northern Ireland post-Brexit in terms of increases of hate crime. We haven't seen that to the same extent in Scotland. I'm not saying it didn't happen, but I'm assured that the police figures are accurate, and something different has happened in Scotland, which is, I think, fascinating in itself. It's a long way of saying we share exactly the same interests of you, and it's very much, I think, in both of our interests to have a further discussion as we work up our plans and you firm up your plans for your inquiry.
I think the committee would appreciate that greatly. Alec Colton.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you very much for coming to see us today. I have two sort of areas I'd like to discuss. The first is quite a broad area. Rebecca, you've mentioned several times about the role of your organisation in terms of treaty monitoring. And I think when we sort of first formed as a committee, or reformed as a committee in the summer, we were looking to the concluding observations of the various UN treaties as a weather vane as to where we should direct our work. But considering there are some 900 plus concluding observations, it could be at times like drinking from a fire hose. I just wanted to ask how you triage those and how you use them to shape the work of your organisations. Which are the low-hanging fruit? Which are the absolute golden priorities? How maybe you could help us in terms of shaping our approach to the concluding obs.
Thank you. So the treaty monitoring work that we do does lie at the heart of our organisation, and I'm very proud of that particular function. It has quite a high regard within the country. So lots of different ways of answering that question. So both, I suppose, starting structurally, one of the things that we've done recently is we have allied the treaty monitoring function with our research function, which are now being brought together within the same team. So part of what we're looking now is doing is looking across the board in terms of what our evidence base is and what comes out of concluding observations, so that we can sort of use that to inform our policy work much more clearly going forward. And a lot of the work that we're doing in terms of our restructure is about the ability to look much more clearly across the organisation to ensure that the work that we do informs what the various different teams are working on, instead of kind of being back in the silo culture. So I would say that internally, for us, it's about looking at the concluding observations and mapping them across the work that we do, using our internal criteria that we use to prioritise work against what comes out. Because we work across all the international human rights treaties against which we report on the country's compliance, we are, of course, very keenly aware of what the overlaps are. We've got that advantage of not being tied to one specific treaty, but just for example, because it's an obvious one, when we look at issues around access to justice and the impact of legal aid reform and of employment tribunal fees on different groups, because it's disproportionate in relation to women, and because it's also been found to be disproportionate in relation to disabled people and to ethnic minorities, that will come up in different treaties as a concluding observation, and we can identify where the overlaps are and where the strength is in terms of an issue that we would want to look at as a priority. Another thing that we're doing is that we are talking to Westminster, and it's a really helpful conversation to have with you about what our relationship is with Parliament in terms of taking forward those concluding observations. And I think one of the things that my sense is that while it's been a really important piece of work for us, we haven't perhaps been as strategic as we need to be in terms of finding a structure within which we can flag up those concluding observations and take them forward, working closely with select committees to flag up our concerns around them. So what you will find is that they are referred to in our casework, in the reports that we do, and in the work that we do. But we would really welcome an opportunity to work with you, perhaps as a sort of a regular report, perhaps as some sort of structure whereby we can flag up what we regard as the key concerns under concluding observations and work with you to bring them to the attention of the Scottish Parliament. I don't know whether you want to add to that, Chris.
Again, perhaps just as a very practical example of that, again, both the committee and ourselves share significant concerns about identity-based bullying in schools. It's an issue which comes up across a number of treaties. It's an issue which we've done a lot of research on and worked very closely, particularly with LGBT youth and others, and Respect Me. And we have recommendations which we're putting back to the education department about how we feel the relationship or the responsibilities of schools and education authorities could be adjusted to give greater information and greater protection to children experiencing that.
Okay. Well, thank you both very much for that answer. I think this is a subject we'll return to, I'm certain of that. Chris, I wanted to pick up something you specifically mentioned in your opening remarks about maternity discrimination.
I'm really sorry. I've got a bit of a hearing problem.
Oh, I apologise.
Today,
I'll speak up.
Thank you.
I wanted to return to something you said in your opening remarks, specifically about maternity discrimination, the number of women who lose their jobs as a result of their pregnancy. I've been working with a constituent who has a blog called Stay at Home CEO, who is an astonishing person who was largely managed out as a result of her maternity situation whilst being chief executive of an organisation by a very unprogressive board. I think she really opened my eyes to the scale of the problem. What astonished me was the number of blue chip household name companies which do this as a kind of matter of systemic concern. What role do you have to call these companies out? Because I could name them right now. maybe be sued in the morning, but it strikes me that we really need to shine a light, because I was really astonished at just how prevalent it were, and the fact that in a lot of ways the victims of this discrimination within these big companies aren't even aware of each other. Yes. And I think that one of the first steps to my mind in terms of ending this practice is to really shine a light on it and name and shame. Mm. Can you offer some reflections on that?
Absolutely. We published extensive research on this last year. I think it was, and it's been a major theme of our work going forward. There are two distinct groups of women being affected in quite distinct ways. So we have younger women, often in low-skilled, ununionized workplaces, who are often just simply fired. And it's just straightforward, really quite bald. And then we have another group of women, quite distinct, perhaps more in line with the situation you're describing, where they're professional and that they find that they're being overlooked for promotion, they're being downgraded, they come back to work to find that somebody else is doing their job. So discrimination is different, and depending on the sector that you work on, we find leisure, caring, there are particular issues there, and then there are particular issues in finance. So we need to take slightly different approaches to these. It's not an issue that is devolved to the Scottish Government, but we have been working very closely with the Scottish Government on this. We're very pleased that Mr. Hepburn has taken this issue up very strongly. First Minister has made commitments. Inevitably, we have a working group, but it's a group of good people who are plugged in from the STUC, from ACAS, from other people. And we're looking at, firstly, how do we let people, let women know what their rights are? And I think it's very much that thing that it's almost, to me, it's unimaginable in 2017 that this is going on. But it's so ingrained sometimes in workplace culture that women just keep their heads down. There's a real issue. We know from our research that the more you know about your rights, the more likely you are to be able to negotiate with your employer and put them right. So there's a big emphasis on our work with the Scottish Government about letting women know that this is wrong and letting women know that there are remedies here. The tribunal situation, obviously, is really problematic because for many, particularly the younger, lower-paid women, going to tribunal on this issue is just simply not an issue. So again, we support the Scottish Government's move towards more kind of arbitration-type measures, but we're also really interested in positive incentives here, that there are the vast majority of companies, we reckon about 80% of companies, are doing the right thing. So it's focusing on the 20% who are doing the wrong thing and using things, levers, things like the Fair Work Convention, things like the Business Pledge, to encourage people to shift practice. Sometimes employers do this out of ignorance, sometimes they do it out of malice. Where it's ignorance, we want to try and help them to understand. We've done a whole pile of resources on our website, you know, helpful things which they can look at and do. But obviously, you know, where there are cases where the behaviour is so high-handed, we again reserve the right to take legal action should we need to. We're very much in persuasive mode in Scotland on this just now. And we're very grateful of the support of the government, who were the first in the UK to come out very clearly on this. And it very clearly is very clearly a matter of principle in Scotland, which we're very heartened by. I suspect it's going to take time to resolve, but we think we're on the front foot with it.
If I can just add to that and endorse what Chris said, we're working with business to identify what good practice looks like, and there is some fantastic good practice out there, and so for us it's really about helping people to learn from each other. It's definitely about identifying the carrots, and we, for example, published a report sort of autumn last year looking at what the financial penalty was for maternity and pregnancy discrimination, because it's not inconsiderable, and I don't just mean for the individuals but for the companies as well. It's another sort of interesting reflection on use of litigation, because when we did the research into pregnancy and maternity, we particularly focused on trying to pick up litigation in the area. And we did pick up cases, but they all settled. These are very rarely cases that you can actually take through, because by their nature, employers will pay off the individuals. And so it's quite difficult to make a mark that way, which is one of the reasons why we're focusing on that really key issue of making people aware of their rights. We have called again in this area for employment tribunal fees to be reduced, and in fact for the time to be the deadline to be delayed in order to be able to allow women to take cases. And we've also looked at measures to improve health and safety in business, because sometimes it's as basic as that, and it's an awareness of people's physical environment, the importance of making them safe.
Great, thank you.
Thank you, thank you. Jeremy.
thank you, and good morning, thank you very much for coming. I wonder if I can ask two questions, one at a reasonably high level and one at a more kind of, one of the issues that Chris has raised. If I can go to a high level issue, I'm still fairly new to all of this, but I noticed that in your report, there's some financial cutbacks coming. So I wonder just what effect will that have that on Scotland? And what relationship do you have with other organisations doing similar work in Scotland, and so that you're not duplicating each other's work?
I talk about money and you talk about other people. thank you. We have had a cut of 25% imposed on us under the latest spending review. We were asked to model cuts of 40% and 25%. We resisted it very fiercely. We were hoping not to be cut or to be cut by less, but we were imposed with a 25% cut. And I'm happy to talk about that as it affects the Commission as a whole. But in relation to Scotland particularly, which I think was where the direction of your question was, it's actually not impacted on Scotland in any great, in any negative way. There is a particular approach to the remodelling of our organisation that I think has actually strengthened the Scottish resource quite considerably. That is because one of the ways in which we are looking to remodel the organisation is about making sure that we have a more coherent approach to the devolved administrations. And as you know, we also have an office in Cardiff. One of the concerns that we always have is to ensure that the work that we do in Scotland is targeted and effective in relation to the Scottish specific issues, but also that as a GB organisation we operate effectively, and Scotland isn't the forgotten bit and Wales isn't the forgotten bit, that we offer a sort of coherent, effective whole. So what we have done is that we have appointed an executive director, and the three executive directors are the highest officials in the Commission, reporting directly to me, each of whom have a specific responsibility for one of the countries, for England and Scotland and Wales. And so Scotland benefits from having an executive director as well as a new individual who's coming in to lead the team specifically at a Scottish level. I'm happy to talk about the changes in the Commission that affect the Commission as a whole and how they impact on Scotland, but I think that is probably the single biggest change, which I regard as a big plus for Scotland. I'm hoping that it will help us to work more effectively with Glasgow going forward. Chris, did you want to pick up?
Yeah, there are so many examples. I think that the fundamental point, we are a relatively small organisation in Scotland. There's 17, 18 of us. We are reliant on working with and through other people to achieve our aims. So stakeholders, relationships are enormously important to us, trying to use the influence and the leverage that we have. So perhaps just to go back to the pregnancy maternity example, we've been engaging really closely, not just with the Scottish Government in terms of the business pledge and the Fair Work Convention. We've been working with some of the voluntary sector around, say, working families, in gender, maternity action, also looking to the NHS in terms of other opportunities for health visitors or midwives to reinforce messages to mothers, expectant mothers or new mothers. It's really about trying to cut the cloth of what we're doing and mapping who else is doing what, so we don't end up replicating work. Obviously, the most critical relationship, I would say, is with the Scottish Human Rights Commission, where we have the blurring, potentially, of roles. The Scottish Human Rights Commission having primacy over devolved human rights matters, ourselves having primacy over reserved human rights matters. When we look at something like human trafficking, it isn't as simple as that. It isn't just an immigration issue. It's a policing and a health issue in Scotland. So before we engage in any new major piece of work, we have to look around and see who else is active in the area, who's doing what, and how can we best use the resource that we have to work with the flow in Scotland rather than to take oppositional positions. I think we're very lucky in Scotland. The voluntary sector, the public sector, and other regulators are quite coherent, and there is quite a strong sense of partnership, so it's not a difficulty. But we are very, very conscious of the resource that we have and playing to the particular strengths that we can bring to a table, which might be a research strength, a particular legal perspective, or a particular policy input that other people don't necessarily have.
So. Okay, thank you. I suppose the second question was picking up your point, Chris, in one in five in regard to seeing disabled people. I'm interested to know what work you're doing at the kind of more grassroots level, because we hear a lot about maybe Scottish Parliament, local authorities, but I was interested, you were talking about community councils, tenants, organisations, and things like that. There may well be, and if there is, you can maybe point me in a direction. Is there data around that in regard to what is the representation on community councils from different diversity groups and other areas like that? And even at council level, have you done any work in regard to scoping where councils across Scotland sit in regard to diversity?
Okay. I would stress, firstly, we're not a community development organisation. The staff are 17 people. We simply cannot do that type of work. So we work very much through and with those organisations, like One in Five, who have that particular remit and interest. In terms of participation, it's an issue which we've picked up on in Is Scotland Fairer. We've pulled together the data that there is, and the data is not strong in Scotland. We do not know the composition of community councils. There is no requirement on community councils to collect monitoring data. I'm very interested in things like tenants associations and that ladder of participation, that you cut your teeth on something local and move through. After every local government election, COSLA does a diversity survey of elected members, but not of candidates. So again, it's interesting that we know who gets through, but we don't know who doesn't. It's not always very well completed, so there are issues about data gaps there. We kind of work anecdotally is that we there is a clear gender imbalance we can see at a local level in local authorities. There is a lack of ethnic minority candidates. There are a lack of people with declared disabilities, but we suspect there are a number of people with hidden disabilities that they don't necessarily share with their colleagues. I think it's very interesting that as we're moving into the public appointment system and the new regulations coming in there, which we've been working very closely with the government on, it's about having better information to enable non-departmental public bodies to know what's the composition of our board. If we have nobody who's LGBT, or if we have nobody who's under 30 or 40, what are we going to do to plan? So there's whole emphasis on succession planning, which the government published documentation about a couple of days ago. It's one of these things where the commission has a very strong interest, but it is not our sole responsibility. So we work with the appointments commissioners. We're very interested to engage with the parties, with the parliament, with other people doing the same work. But it's a collective effort which is going to get us there. So again, we are looking, when COSLA completes and publishes its research, that will become an active thing that we will then start to use to say, well, this is the result. How do we improve this going forward to have a more reflective form of local democracy than perhaps we do just now?
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Mary.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. I wanted to ask you about, strategic aim 2 and bullet point 2.2, developing levers for change. I wonder if you could possibly give us an update on where you are with the pilot programme. You talked about the two-year project to improve understanding of levers that are effective in reducing discrimination, and go on to say that you'll use this research to help us pilot and evaluate the effectiveness of interventions. Can you update us on where you are? When will you be starting the actual practical work? And when will you be ready to report back?
So, thank you. So that's a piece of work that we're looking at in terms of informing how we operate across mm-hmm. the board. We commissioned a piece of work last year looking at what influences people's discriminatory behaviours, if you like, what takes you from a sort of prejudiced mindset to unlawful acts. One of the interesting pieces of research that we produced was in relation to hate crime, and so it takes us back to the question asked earlier about what we're doing in relation to the refugee crisis, because there's been quite a lot of work that we've done, not just in terms of looking at the sort of spike in hate crime, but what works in trying to address it. What we discovered was quite complex in terms of causation. There are lots of different kinds of hate crime, depending on what the motivation is. There are 4 different kinds of motivation, and it depends on where the situation is in terms of where the locality of the hate crime is and what kind of victim is a victim of a hate crime might be in relation to perhaps being a disabled person or whether they are from an ethnic minority. And all these things influence how the hate crime comes about and what the motivation is. And one of the other things that we found out through that piece of work was that there's been very little done by way of intervention to try to actually understand what works. We know that there's been some successful work in relation to identity bullying in schools. We also know that overall what tends to be effective in that place is bringing people together, and that prejudice is always, well, prejudice is often helped by you're able to actually bring people face to face with people who look different or are a bit different. So last year that was an example of a piece of work where we looked at sort of causation, we looked at what has been done across the piece, and as I say, generally speaking, we found that there's a very low level of understanding of this area, particularly in relation to kind of very different protected characteristics, and I'm about to forget which one it is, but I think most of them are clustered around gender. I may have got that one wrong. So in terms of understanding what prejudice looks like across the field, there hasn't been enough work undertaken in relation to what works. That was the sort of first bit. In terms of looking at that going forward, as Chris said, we are in the middle of business planning at the moment. So it's really looking at the areas of work that we're going to be engaged with, and looking at working with other organisations and using the research that we've done to ensure that we identify the right levers going forward, in order to ensure that we're actually approaching things from as an effective place as possible. At this stage, I'm not able to be more specific than that, but we're very happy to keep you up to date with our thinking.
Yeah, that'd be very helpful. And can I just briefly ask you as well about strategic aim number 1? You talk about stereotyped media reporting, and there's almost a link between what you've been saying and how you're going to look at stereotyped media reporting, because you say you're going to seek to build your understanding of factors contributing to environments where open expressions of prejudice against particular groups. And it's something that has angered and perplexed me for a considerable length of time, particularly in the print media, the language that they use to describe certain sectors of society. And if I think, 2 that come to the front of my mind would be offenders and their families and gypsy travellers. and the language that is used to describe those groupings of people certainly do nothing to quell discrimination or remove discrimination. And I have spoken to print media, and print media have told me that that's the language that the people that buy their newspapers want to read. So I just wonder how you will take that forward in conjunction with the rest of the work that you're doing.
Shall I pick up that first?
You start.
Yeah. I think, as you'll know, I mean, we share a really strong concern about attitudes towards gypsy travellers and behaviour towards gypsy travellers. To the extent that we have published and republished guidance for editors in Scotland about how to report on gypsy traveller issues without prejudice, it is unique. We have not felt the need to do that for any other group. And it really is, I think it just signals the deep concern that we have too. There was a fairly obscure European case emanating from Latvia, oddly, which has recently confirmed that print media and online media are responsible for hate speech which is posted on their blog spaces. And that's been really useful because we've kind of circulated that around editors. I have to say, and I've been involved in gypsy traveller work for a very long time, and there seems to be a tempering in the media now that some of the stuff that we saw maybe 5-10 years ago, where newspapers were camping fake gypsy traveller caravans outside council offices, some of that has seemed to dissipate. I don't know if there's just a different cadre of editors have come in. I noticed particularly that in a number of the previously worst offending newspapers, they no longer have bulletin board comments underneath gypsy traveller stories. I mean, I'm not saying, you know, clearly this is stuff is still going on in social media, clearly it's still going on Facebook. But I think we have made some progress there, and I'm heartened to see that, you know, I don't see the same sort of stuff that perhaps you and I both viewed years ago. We have, perhaps linking to your previous question as well, we're very interested in what works. One of the big problems around prejudice and hate crime is that we see a number of... Something bad happens. There's a community response where people set up a project and they do more contact work or and then it shuts down and nobody ever documents it. And we found this very much with rehabilitation of hate crime offenders when we published on this a few years ago, is that, quite frankly, nobody knows what works. And so we've commissioned a body you lobby for with CREAR, Coalition Against Racism, based in Glasgow, to precisely to help design tools to help these small types of projects to evaluate and document what they're doing. Because my concern, I guess, is that everybody feels good when we're doing a demo or whatever, but is it having long-term impact? Are we just going to have to go back 3 years down the line and fight the same problem just round the corner? So we're really interested in what is practically going to work to reduce these types of prejudices, to reduce these types of tensions, so that we can recommend this type of thing. Again, hearteningly, most recently, Scottish Social Attitudes Survey, which we co-fund and have co-funded all the way through. The attitudes towards LGBTI communities in Scotland, negative attitudes, have collapsed. I mean, it's quite remarkable. And I think that's to do with better media representation, it's to do with soap operas, it's to do with all these different things. But some communities, Muslims, gypsy travellers, people with mental health problems, these attitudes persist. And I think that's where we're really interested. We're not the only players in this market. We don't have all of the solutions to it, but working with the government, with the police, with local authorities who have a duty to reduce or to promote good community relations, that's what we want to try and crack. But it's very volatile, and as the convener says, sometimes it's subject to things which happen many thousands of miles away.
If I can add to that, just briefly, some of that comes back to comments we made earlier, in relation to the political discourse, and want the work that we see coming out of the Brexit referendum. We are working with political parties across the piece, and we've written to them to suggest that there needs to be some work done in relation to the impact of words which sometimes can be used quite casually on the political stage but have a magnifying impact. It's not just about what happens in the media, because it's about looking at the whole piece and how that sort of interrelates. We are hoping to persuade political parties to sort of look at some sort of voluntary pledge or code of conduct, which absolutely is not about impinging on freedom of speech. And it's not about the sort of criminal space, which of course is kind of separately dealt with, but it's about recognising the impact of words. But there's also something about the responsibility for websites for the material that they host. And there have been, I'm coming back to the question about treaty monitoring, there have been recommendations by the UN on a more robust duty on internet service providers and website hosts to look at that material in terms of their responsibilities lawfully. And just coming back to what Chris was saying about making sure that we do what works and we identify the right levers, one of the changes that we're looking at as part of our restructuring is a more systematic and more robust look at measuring the impact of what we do, which is something that we're very, very conscious of. And we've been looking at a sort of a theory of change across all our business planning and looking at the ways that we work in to make sure that we have a more unified and more effective framework within which we should be accountable for all the things that we do to ensure impact. And obviously, that issue about sort of discourse and impacts on the lives of disadvantaged communities like gypsies and travellers is part of that.
Okay, thanks. That's very helpful. I'll come back later with jobs.
Yeah, okay, thanks, Mary. Willie Coffey.
Thank you very much, Convener, and hello to you. I just wanted to ask in general terms how you decide who does what pieces of work between Rebecca, your organisation, and the Scottish organisation, how that kind of division of responsibility actually works. I'm looking at the business plan in front of us, and I'm looking specifically for Scottish programmes of work, and there's a page in there out of 38 pages in the document. So I'm just wondering if there's enough, do you think there's enough treatment of the Scottish programme of work in a document like this for members of the Scottish Parliament and indeed the Scottish public to get a grasp of?
Thank you for that. I might answer very briefly from a sort of high level and then expect Chris to talk more about some sort of specifics. I think it's probably fair to say that the Scotland Office have sort of two roles. They are about supporting what the organisation does on a GB level. And then there are things that they do which are very much Scotland specific. And that's about recognising that some of the issues that surface for us as a commission, we look at across the board, but they look different in Scotland. And then there are some things that the Scotland Office do which are only going to be germane to them, relevant to them. It's enormously important to me that the work that goes on in our office in Scotland is robust and effective and properly resourced, in proportion to the rest of the office. As I've said earlier, much of what we have done recently in changing the way we work has been part of that, and to ensure that we have proper proper resource, but also proper sort of communication across the board, so that what happens in Scotland is tied in at a senior level to what the Commission does. And I think that's helped recently by the fact that we have a new commissioner here in Scotland, and we're looking at new ways of working that involve a more sort of coherent dialogue between her and between the chair of the Commission and me. And the executive directors. I don't know whether you want to pick up on sort of specific examples of that, Chris.
I'll maybe give you an example where it's relatively easy and an example where it's becoming more complex. The work that we're doing around pregnancy and maternity, it's reserved legislation. HR practice north and south of the border is largely the same. So a lot of what we do, we can generate the same sorts of messages, the same sorts of tools and resources, and the responsibility in the Scottish team is who do we relate to in Scotland, in the government, the voluntary sector, to move that message. And that's probably one of the most coherent GB parts of what we do. If you take something like criminal justice, the Is Britain Fairer, which is the overarching analysis of Britain, would show you, particularly from England, that there is a huge overrepresentation of ethnic minority people being stopped and searched, and that there is a worrying concentration of Afro-Caribbean people in locked wards under psychiatric detention. Now, in Scotland, I'm assured from looking at the stop and search figures and working with the police that there is no disproportionality in race in terms of stop and search. But as we all know, we've had a very worrying issue about a concentration on young people and the impact of relations between younger people and the police. In terms of psychiatric treatment, whilst there's very strong evidence of an over-intervention in England, which results in black people being sectioned, in Scotland, I would argue, actually, what we see is almost an under-intervention, that people from ethnic minorities experience mental distress without support at home. So what we try to agree in our planning is that there are big themes and concerns: health, criminal justice, stop and search, but that we leave sufficient room for England, Scotland and Wales to be able to deal with their own specific issues. Some of the issues around stop and search in England, I think arguably you could say, are predominantly urban issues, which affect London and Birmingham and Manchester and don't necessarily. So again, it's being trying to be sensitive and responsive and flexible to what we're being presented with. Again, I would come back to the point that for us in Scotland particularly, it's about working in partnership with other agencies. It's absolutely critical. It's neither desirable for us to simply tell people you must do this. We have to work with through people to help them to understand, and then for them. But ultimately, they run the housing department. They run the psychiatric ward. We don't. We can only advise on equality and human rights principles. I hope that's gone some way to answering your question.
It helps. Supposing you were doing a piece of work that was on some reserved matter.
I'm sorry, I'm having a wee bit of
trouble. Beg your pardon, right. Supposing you were doing some kind of piece of work that was on a reserved matter, as you mentioned there, Chris, how do people in, say, Scotland or Wales know whether that message is applicable here or in Wales, or whether it's just applicable to England? How do you make that clear when you're reporting? It's a bit like the issue, convener, when you hear reports on something like the BBC, who tell a story about a particular issue, and people are left wondering, is that NHS England they're talking about, or Scotland, or Wales, and so on and so forth? Do you make clear who you're talking about when you're reporting the findings that you find?
I'm sure Rebecca will remember many conversations I've had. I also do communications where I go back and say, actually, that press release is talking about England. So we don't always get it right, and I accept that, but we do try very hard, and we are very, very precious in Scotland and in Wales of the distinctiveness of the need we have to message. It's not a unique problem, and as you say, you know, the BBC routinely, you know, you switch on and think, that isn't Scotland that you're talking about here. So with the best will in the world, we are fighting against we are a small country and attached to a much larger country, and sometimes the nuance and the subtlety gets lost. We try and counter that by being communicative, by engaging with our stakeholders, and I think most of the people that we work with in Scotland get it. You know, if you listen to the Today programme, you know when they're talking about England and you know when they're talking about Scotland. And I think that people in Scotland and Wales often are more constitutionally literate in that sense than perhaps some of our colleagues down south. That's maybe not a fair question. I think I should be quiet now.
I will come in.
I really thank you for that response. I wonder if I could ask you another question, and you might not be able to answer it. It's about one of your reports on your website. It was about disabled access to soccer grounds, and it is an English issue because it was the English Premier League that was involved in it, and it wasn't yourselves that did the piece of work, although you were involved in it. And the frightening message that came from it is that a third of the clubs in the English Premier League are unlikely to comply with guidance for disabled access, and that's astonishing, because when you consider that there's a large number of them, I mean, there's huge amounts of money going into those football clubs, and they can't comply with basic things like that. So I'm wondering why organisations like yourself aren't involved with these clubs when they're building these shiny, fancy new stadiums, because the messages that you would deliver in commentary after the fact, if they were delivered at the design stage, would be so much more helpful. Are you ever invited to participate in that kind of process, whether it's football or whether it's designing new housing or new schools? Are you involved at the sharp end and the front end, and if not, how do we achieve that?
Well, I'd start off by saying I completely agree with you. It's mind-boggling that the disabled access to Premier League clubs isn't better than it is. In fact, isn't perfect, given the resources that are available. And that is an area that we are working closely with the Premier League. We're looking at information that we're gathering on that, and we will look to enforce any gaps in compliance that we find. It is a very important area for actually a couple of reasons. I think it's really important that if you are a Premier League fan, you have just as many rights as anybody else does to go and watch your club perform. But I also think there's a very important message in terms of a very high profile area of our life, where, you know, if the Premier League can't get it right, then there's a sort of message that goes across to other people. And I think if they can take it seriously, then there are kind of gains to be made outside the sphere itself. I mentioned our work into disabled housing. We just launched an inquiry in that space, and that's precisely one of the things that we want to look at. We've identified the finance gap, if you like, between adapting a house that has not been built to be compliant with disability access after the fact, in comparison to sort of building it from the get-go with that in mind. So that's exactly the kind of issue that we want to flag up, we want to identify. Again, as Chris was saying, and we always say, and it's a hard, it's a sad thing to come back to, but that you know, we are a limited number of people, so we have to act strategically. And that ability to influence things at the start is always going to be far more effective than sort of picking off enforcement bits after the fact across the piece. I don't know if that's a kind of specific Scottish angle you want to add to that.
Other than just to say, I mean, earlier on I mentioned that the opportunities of investment. We have 50,000 affordable houses being built in Scotland. We have 17,500 wheelchair users who are inappropriately housed. We have a real opportunity to get this right. I have a real fear that we could get this wrong. I look at local housing plans and I see need being profiled quite well. What I don't see is resource being moved. Now, it's not just a social issue, it's not just a moral issue, it's also an economic issue, because what ends up is we end up with people being inappropriately located in hospital beds. You know, so it's in everybody's interests to design 21st century towns and neighbourhoods. And we're really interested in looking at issues of spatial planning, of housing planning, of investment, that we can squeeze every bit of equality benefit out of that. As I said earlier on, whether it's in terms of the house that people can live in or who builds the house and the economic opportunities that that brings, we have real... I'm quite excited about it. There's a real opportunity here to do things right, but we won't do it right unless we pay attention to it. And that's where I think it's issues, you know, of leadership from the committee, from politicians, from senior people in the professions. Say, we've all got a shared common interest in getting this right. Can we just get it right this time? So.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Can I pick up on that point, because one of my bugbears is equality impact assessments and the quality of the information contained within. Now, you'll have realised last week the Scottish Government put out a call for evidence or a consultation on a review of the planning system.
Yes.
Now, it seems to me that these issues could be resolved at planning stage if an equality impact assessment is done properly with quality information in that. Now, what I want to know is whether you will insert yourself into that process of the review for planning in order to ensure that equality impact assessment and that building into the infrastructure of accessibility is there, whether you'll do that. So that's one question. But also see from your report that you're disbanding the Disability Committee. So how can you realise the actions of the CRPD report without having a discrete committee who would undertake that work.
Shall I do with the first part?
No, I'll do the second.
Mm-hmm. Completely agree with you. What we're putting to the Scottish Government in terms of a kind of vision around particularly city deals and investment is that there are three essential points. There's a point about planning, there's a point about equality and analysis and information, and there's a point about procurement. And we have real opportunities. My frustration, I think, in a lot of the equality impact assessments that I see is that people focus on the first part of the duty. Are we doing harm? Are we eliminating discrimination? Mm-hmm. And they stop.
Yeah.
And they don't then think, are we advancing equality of opportunity? Are we fostering good community relations? So this is the opportunity part of it. It's not just about not doing bad things. It's about doing things better and about doing including things. So we're very much, I mean, that this is the emphasis we want to take with this work. I have seen equality impact assessments from other governments where they look at things like city deals and they say there is no equality impact. And you go, well, I find that almost impossible to understand how you've reached that conclusion, because there must be opportunity here, surely. So I think we're very much talking the same thing. Capacity, capability sometimes is limited. I would like to see greater senior management scrutiny and member scrutiny of quality impact assessments. I'd like to see them being used more actively in decision making. It's a process. It's better than it was when it was introduced. We're getting better at it. Part of what we want to do is to identify the good practice and to share that with people so that they understand this is a really good way of approaching this. And we did come a bit late to the table with the Aberdeen City deal, but we were able to work with the Scottish Government to say, look, there are things you can do here, and we want to take that forward into the next city deals to really start to drill home exactly those issues that you're raising.
Okay, what about the review of planning? Is that something that you would be taking part in?
Met with Planning Aid Scotland on Monday to have a chat about what they're up to, So yes, we fully intend to engage in evidence and committee sessions on that and have some suggestions to make, some of which are around Gypsy Traveller sites, about how we might actually start to look at different ways of looking at these issues.
Yep. Okay, Rebecca.
Thank you. So the Disability Committee, I'm sure you're aware of this, was the subject of an independent review and a decision by government to end its statutory footing.
Rebecca, did you say a decision by government to end its statutory footing?
That's a statutory instrument that's now been passed. We are in the middle of looking at a sort of transition model. This Disability Committee still exists in its statutory form until the end of this year, until the 31st of March, and thereafter we will be looking at a sort of transition stage, which we're currently in the middle of modelling. I think I'd say a couple of things. I think first of all I'd say it's absolutely not the case that disability generally as an issue is not very important to the Commission. Our chair, David Isaac, holds it as one of his key priorities, and he's spoken to that theme on a number of occasions. We've committed that either he or I will attend every current meeting of the committee while it exists. And in fact, I would be there now, but I chose to come here instead this morning. But the opportunity of the change in status and the transition. The transition modelling has afforded us the ability to actually look at it and say, well, what works and what doesn't work. And I should pay tribute to the Disability Committee members because they very much engaged with that. And we had a long meeting with them just before Christmas to review that and to identify what the strengths and weaknesses were of the former current way of working. And I would say, sort of as a headline thing, I think what we have struggled with is a model which has separated out the disability arm of the Commission into this kind of separate place with a group of people who have looked at our work slightly outside what has happened, I think, historically in relation to other protected characteristics. To go back to sort of new ways of working, one of the things we're trying to do is embed much more joined up ways of working across the organisation, and that goes to looking at every protected characteristic. What we want to do, what we are doing, is identifying leads in the Commission to look at how every single protected characteristic plays out in our work and to ensure that it's consistent and effective and robust where it needs to be. We think that will embed disability as an area of you know, as a key priority, as a protected characteristic, and obviously, as you say, in relation to the work that needs to be taken forward in relation to CRPD, much more effectively than having having it sort of sit under a disability committee, which has, I think, it's probably fair to say, not, and it would say itself, not necessarily been as connected as effectively as it ought to have been to the leadership and the work of the Commission as a whole. In addition to that, we are looking at upskilling, I don't like that word, developing and training staff as a whole, so that we'll be able to look at people working in this area who I think are going to be able to take up the work very effectively going forward. We're not obviously looking at moving away from that very important aspect of our work, which is about stakeholder engagement. The Disability Committee has been very important in doing that, but it's something that we will continue or just look a bit different. Stakeholder engagement has been one of the key skills by which we have looked at identifying people who are moving into our new operating model, and so that's an area that I would expect to be very much at the forefront of work taken forward.
Yeah, can you see why there would be a concern if something loses its statutory force, that would be a concern, given the rollback in many of the rights that we currently enjoy? There's talk about withdrawal from the Council of Europe, repeal of the Human Rights Act, the Trade Union Bill, all of these things that seem to undermine and weaken the current rights that we have. So can you see why there would be such a concern if something loses its statutory footing? And I understand about it being placed within all the other protected characteristics, but if there's no statutory force behind that, how do we ensure that it maintains its importance and its drive?
I absolutely and completely understand where you're coming from, and we can, you know, more than happy to talk about, since you mentioned it, the work that we are going to be doing in relation to the implications for Brexit on the lack of having that constitutional framework going forwards. So I am absolutely on the same page as you. And I entirely understand what it looks like, which is why I started off this session saying that it was fabulous to have an opportunity to come and talk and understand each other's perspectives better. But I would say, I suppose, stepping back a little bit and picking up on the questions that were asked earlier about gypsy and traveller disadvantage, this is relevant. I think this is an area where the Commission, perhaps fair to say, four or five years ago, was not doing as much work as it could have done. We've done an enormous amount of work with the gypsy and traveller community. A large number of the cases that we've taken up over the past two or three years since I've been at the Commission have been in that place, and I think that our relationships with the community are very effective, and the amount of information that is passed to us through our relationships with them is incredibly useful, and it enables us to take both a strategic and a very impactful approach to disadvantage in what I think maybe fair to say in some ways is the most disadvantaged ethnic group in Great Britain. But we don't have a statutory committee for race. That's work that we undertake by being an effective commission, and we are networked, and it's about our ways of taking forward something that we think is really important and having an impact. And that's how I would see us working in relation to disability as well.
Yeah, Mary's going to come in, but I would rather have seen all of those protected characteristics having a statutory force than a withdrawal from one. So that's my point. Mary?
Can I just ask a very brief supplementary in relation to the Disability Committee? Because it's my understanding that the Lords Committee made a recommendation to the Commission that the Disability Committee be reconstituted, and the decision was taken by the Commission not to do that.
Well, the statutory instrument's already been passed. That's not in our gift.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you.
Can I move on to, because you've talked a wee bit about some of the reorganisation that's gone on, and you'll imagine there has been some discourse about the reorganisation and how that happened. And you may not be able to answer this question, but one of the concerns that we have is the fact that the reorganisation and the changes that have came about from that, including possible compulsory redundancies, were not discussed with the devolved administrations. I don't know whether that's something you can answer, Rebecca, but if you can give us any insight into why that decision was taken not to discuss that with the devolved administrations, especially in Scotland, when we have just got new additional equality duties conferred on this Parliament?
It's certainly not the case that we sort of declined to discuss them with you. I'm more than happy to come on and talk about them in sort of more depth to sort of identify where they were coming from and what that thinking looked like. To be honest, my position is that this is an internal restructuring. I think it is right and appropriate that we make all our possible best efforts to engage and consult, and particularly with devolved administrations. Our investments are obviously about, for example, our strategic plan and our work areas of priority. We've in fact done that today and on other occasions. But we are independent by statute, and it is quite important that we are seen to be independent and that our internal ways of working are about obviously proper consultation internally and with trade unions. On an informal basis, I am always more than happy to talk about what we're doing. A key driver for our organisation was our strategic plan, which is a matter of what was publicly consulted on. And we would say that because of that, all our key stakeholders have fed indirectly into what we're doing. But we would not regard it as a sort of proper thing to go out and consult externally about how we organise ourselves.
Some of the claims that we have heard is the way that selections have been done, people being, you know, left in precarious employment situations, and a number of them being basic grade members of staff, and the claim that an equality impact assessment, I'm playing devil's advocate here, of course, that a quality impact assessment was maybe not conducted to the depth it should have been, and certainly not shared. Is that something you could answer today?
I'm more than happy to answer. Would it just help if I spent a couple of minutes talking about the restructuring as a whole, just to put it in context?
Okay.
I should start off by saying that I entirely welcome the question, and having said that, I don't think it's necessarily appropriate for an independent body to discuss with government how it organises itself. Doesn't mean to say I'm not happy to answer questions, and I do welcome the interest. I think where I start from is that it's quite important to understand that there were three drivers for the restructuring, it's not simply about a matter of shrinking the organisation. Thank you, Chris. Two or three years ago, we undertook a survey of the Commission internally and identified through that a very keen interest on the part of our staff for a change, a cultural change, and a change in the ways that we work. Shortly after that, because it was we were statutorily obliged to consult on and lay a strategic plan, we did so. It was time to do that, and we laid a new strategic plan in April 2015, which identified new ways of working. Thirdly, as I've already said, we had a cut of 25% imposed on us late 2015 in relation to the spending review. Yes, it has been sadly about having to reduce our headcount, but it's also been, and I think perhaps primarily due to looking at a new way of working. We haven't just lost 25% of our headcount in the spending review. We have lost in the totality over the period of time that the Commission's been in existence over the past 10 years, more like 70-75%. It's never been the case since that opening in 2006 that someone has sat down and said, well, this is how much money we've got. What's the best way of spending it? What's the best way of having an impact? What's the best way of doing what we want to do? And that really was what our strategic plan was about. And it was about saying, well, what is our role? And it was very much about saying, well, we need to be a national voice. We need to be an independent expert body. We identify various roles for ourselves, which was around being an influencer, being an information provider, and having that national voice. And that's very much kind of moving away from, if you like, sort of more frontline activities and more about saying, well, where is the real impact? And so, yes, we have moved. We have had to lose a small number of our roles, but it's also been about creating a whole new organisation, we therefore, in close consultation with the unions and our staff, we came up with a new model. And if you look at the roles that we looked to move staff into, they had higher skill sets, different skill sets. Some jobs were lost because in new way of working, there were particular areas that we didn't need to take forward. And some jobs look different. I'll just give you a couple of examples of that. We've spoken an awful lot this morning. In fact, we've spoken a lot this morning about impact and about strategic working, which plays into this. We've also spoken a lot, and some of your conversations with Chris have played into the importance of working in partnership. Every single person who works for the Commission now has to pass a key competency in stakeholder management because of the importance that we attach to that particular way of working, where once it was sort of something that we did in one particular silo. It's an example of how we're looking at staff across the board to take on a bigger role. I've had to ask all my staff, I'm afraid, to act a little bit outside their comfort zone. Everybody's doing a bit more. I don't mean that they're working longer hours. I don't want them to. But they are very much looking at taking on bigger roles, more strategic roles. And I've mentioned just an example of how we're looking at responsibility for protected characteristics, which is about identifying a group of people for every single protected characteristic in the Commission who will be leading work across the piece to ensure that we are joined up and effective in that place. And we've never done that before. We've been much more ad hoc in terms of what we're doing on race, for example. That won't be the case going forward. And all that adds up to our higher skills and more autonomy. We're looking at a smaller senior management team, a smaller number of directors, which means having to push down responsibility and autonomy for work, which was once, to be honest, escalated inappropriately, so that too much responsibility sat at a higher level. We can't do that anymore, and it wouldn't be right to do it anyway. So we're looking at staff at a lower level who are able to take on that work and take it forward. And I say all that at some length because I think it's quite important to understand that it hasn't just been about losing people. It's about the need to adapt in an incredibly important area at a vital time, and you mentioned some of the external drivers in the world today, to be more effective. I think it's important to say that at every single stage of the way, we have looked at the equality impact of what we've done. The senior members of staff, the executive directors and I, who sat down and looked at every single decision, at every single moment, on every single stage, have taken an enormous amount of time and we've agonised over what we could do. We have made all possible adjustments for our disabled members of staff, above and beyond what sort of compliance looked like. By way of an example, at the last round, we decided to create two completely new posts which had not formally been in the operating model in order to keep two profoundly disabled members of staff on the payroll, and that was a very important thing for us to do. We have looked at the equality impact assessment, and it was, I do need to emphasise this, shared, compiled, drawn up, updated and shared with staff in a timely manner. We first shared it and updated it in, I think it was in the autumn last year, and that was because that was the first time that we were able to identify what the impact was, because that was when we undertook the first stage of the selection processes. And because we've looked at it at every single stage, I'm quite confident that the process that has been implemented has been fair, robust, transparent and evidence-based. But I do need to add two things to that. I think that the EHRC cannot be proud of a result that sees some numbers of BME staff and some numbers of disabled staff without a job at the end of the day. And I'm not standing here before you to say that I'm proud of that or pleased about it. I'm not. To be honest, anybody losing their job is a matter of great sorrow for me. It's an incredibly difficult decision to have had to make, perhaps the hardest thing any of us have ever had to do. But particularly in that space, I believe we need to do better. But I need to separate the sort of present and the past and the future. I've talked about the present, and that's been about the model that we've adopted and the approach that we've taken. And I am quite clear that it was lawful, it was compliant, it was undertaken with all possible reasonable adjustments, and it was fair. But there are historical reasons for how we ended up where we did, which are hard to address now historically, but they do go back to what I'm afraid, I'm coming into the Commission a couple of years ago, there was no positive action going on. There wasn't any work going on, frankly, to mentor or develop anybody at a lower level, let alone people from particular ethnic groups or from disabled people. And that's work that we should have been doing. And it was because we weren't doing it that we ended up where we are now. And what is incredibly important and the most important thing is that we get that right going forward into the future. And I've already asked my senior executive director to set up a group which is looking, or has already started looking, at positive action work within the Commission. And that is going to be about providing the appropriate amount of mentoring, of coaching, of secondment opportunities, of shadowing opportunities, of development and learning. This is all very much at the heart of the new way of working, but it is particularly important that we see more diversity, particularly at the senior level in the Commission, and that we see members of those ethnic communities and disabled staff coming up to share the work of taking forward the Commission.
Yeah, and that's all very welcome indeed, but it gives no comfort to the people who are facing a redundancy situation. Do you know off the top of your head how many vacancies you're currently carrying?
I think we're currently carrying 25.
So the great work that you talked about there about developing staff, is there opportunities in there to develop the staff who are currently facing redundancy to fill those vacancies?
So I talked about looking at the equality impact at every single stage when we were looking at decisions in terms of selecting people for posts, and one of the things that I talked about was identifying new posts for profoundly disabled members of staff. Another thing that we did in relation to every single member of staff and in relation to every single vacant post was look at the issue of developability. You know, can this person is not operating at that level, this person is not currently doing that role, could they be developed into it? And so that thinking has already been done. It's slightly ongoing because the process hasn't come to an end yet. Okay. But that's been a very key part of our thinking.
Okay, so that's an olive branch for those.
Sorry, I didn't hear.
Would that be an olive branch for those people who are maybe facing redundancy situation?
They're aware that they're conversations that we've had.
Okay. Any other questions from committee this morning? Mary, did you want to come back on an employment question?
It has been reported to us that the majority of people who are in danger of losing their job are clustered in the lower grades. Is that correct?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that.
The majority of people who are at risk of losing their job are clustered in the lower pay grades?
Not all of them, but some of them certainly, yes.
So majority or
probably a majority, yes.
Majority. How many people in your organisation in higher grades are disabled or black and minority ethnic?
In higher grades?
Uh-huh.
I would have to check that for... I can only guess, and I'd rather check it and write to you. Can I do that?
Yeah, that'd be helpful. That would be very helpful. And what assessment has been made about how the new operating model will operate in practice? And I appreciate it's a new thing, and it may be difficult to give me any kind of answer, but we've been told that there'll be a domain model operating across Great Britain, which means that staff that are based in Scotland won't just specifically work on Scottish cases or Scottish issues. Do you see that as being a problem, or do you see that as being a good way forward?
I think, well, I'd see it as being a good way forward, but I know I would say that, wouldn't I? But I think if I can talk about it a little bit and then perhaps leave it to Chris to talk about perhaps a sort of specific answer from the coalface, if you like. We are very positive about working across domains, and it's one answer, if you like, to the age-old problem of how do you deal with the Commission, which has such a broad remit. It's this idea that we're looking at six particular domains, and then across that we'll be looking, as I've already made reference to, what protected characteristics look like sort of across the piece. It's enabling us to carry out our own sort of internal strapline, which is about doing fewer, bigger, better things and about identifying specific aims within each domain and ensuring that the work across GB is sort of focused in that place. And that comes back to some of the questions we've had earlier about looking at our impact, and we're only going to be able to measure impact and have the impact we want if it's focused. But within any one of those domains, the work that is done will be both GB specific and Scotland specific, depending on what the specific area is. And in fact, I might ask Chris to kind of give that.
Sorry, before you come in, Chris, can I add then something else that, that you will be able to answer? I take on board the answer that Rebecca said, but perhaps, Chris, you could address that, but you could also address the issue of if you take the new powers that are coming to Scotland, there will be a spike, I would imagine, in inquiries and queries and issues within Scotland because of the new powers. How will the domain model impact that, and how will the staffing in Scotland be able to deal with that?
Okay, that spike's already started. We're getting lots of calls about board appointments and areas like that. For us, I mean, that's actually business as usual in Scotland. We have a group of people who have a specific role and responsibility around the public sector duty, myself, a couple of my colleagues in policy, a couple of the lawyers, and we meet on a regular basis. Every 2 weeks we meet, we look at issues around public sector duty. This is just an ongoing issue. The law changes. It's not just the new powers coming to Scotland, other changes come in. We have issues about private boards of more than, or private companies of more than 250 people having to report publicly. We are, you know, that's just something we have to absorb. So we treat that as being core. And it's just peaks and troughs. We just have to deal with that. In terms of the domains, I think there's always an anxiety when you shift to a new way of working, and that's the case. To me, the issue is about how tightly defined the priority is. And I go back to the example, perhaps, that I used earlier on. If inside our health domain, we were to concentrate on an Anglo-specific issue, which would be about Afro-Caribbean men in psychiatric detention to the exclusion of all other things, then I would have enormous difficulty contributing to that or people in Scotland benefiting from that. If we accept, I think as we do, that there is a general issue about mental health and ethnic minorities across Britain, but it impacts differently in Scotland, and the people in Scotland have the freedom, the resource and the autonomy to explore that and work on that, then that makes sense. Some issues, as I've mentioned earlier, like pregnancy, like employment, it's actually very easy because it really is much more of just a marketing exercise. Other areas, and I think the housing inquiry is a really interesting one, where we have now three sets of housing laws in England, Scotland and Wales. We have different forms of practice. We have different ways of funding and resourcing social care. It's immensely complex. But the advantages of being GB is that there are three different ways of doing things. So just as we can draw from the work that we're doing in Scotland around dignity and respect and social security, we can draw from that to inform our practice elsewhere. So, you know, it's never distinct or absolute. I think it's about ensuring that we have the flexibility internally to work in a devolved manner, and I think we largely do that.
I think I'd agree with that. And just to add, we think we're horrendously complicated as an organisation. I'm sure that other people also think that of themselves, because it isn't just about, for us, the devolved administrations. It's about connecting up across the piece. And we do think that having a networked organisation, which is what the new operating model is about connecting people better together. And I'd just say two things I think that have come out of the way of working is, one is that we, in looking at the domains and business planning now around the domains, we are connecting very fully up to Scotland, so that Scotland and Wales and other teams across the Commission are very much part of that process in a way that I think hasn't really worked particularly well before. But I think leaving room for other staff is always important. It's not actually just about Scotland. It's a conversation I have with the legal team, because, of course, it's about wanting room to react responsibly and take a case that comes up, which you can't possibly plan for, and you need to be able to sort of leave room to be agile. So no business planning process is going to say this is exactly what you're going to do and nothing else, and that applies just as much to Scotland as anywhere else.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
Okay, we have dramatically ran out of time, as is usual, because we end up having really good discussions across the table on things we're interested in. Can I thank you both for coming along to committee, and thank you for your current work and the ongoing work that we'll be hopefully working along with you closely. Can I reiterate that we would really appreciate the regular report on the concluding ops, because that's something that we've taken a keen interest in, and any aspect that helps us to understand some of that will be very, very welcome indeed. We've got some other issues that we'd like to have brought up with you this morning, but we've been unable to do that. So with the support of the committee, we'll maybe write to you on some of these to seek some clarification on other points. We would have been here until the afternoon if we had touched on them all. So that's maybe a way to do things going forward, if you're happy with that.
Well, we're absolutely welcome hearing from you. We'd welcome writing back to you to clarify. I'd welcome another invitation. It's been my first visit here today, and thank you very, very much for having us.
Yeah, excellent. Thank you so much. That concludes our business in public today, so I now move into private session and suspend for a comfort break.